presented yesterday. It's Alberto de la Fuente from Spain. Just to remind you that he's a PhD civil engineer and associate professor at the Civil and Environmental Engineering. His research interest is focused in the field of optimization of concrete structures, fiber-reinforced concrete design, and material characterizations, as well as on aspects related to multi-criteria decision-making system for sustainability assessment. Has published more than 30 scientific research papers, supervised PhD thesis and Master of Science thesis, and he has led several research transfer projects with national and international construction companies and directly involved with various FIB task groups. The topic of his presentation is the advantages of fiber-reinforced concrete from designing the mix to the use.
Thank you, Chairman. Well, thank you again for assisting in this presentation. It's a continuation of what I did yesterday, talking about fiber-reinforced concrete pipes. But now I'm going to talk about fiber-reinforced concrete control, quality control. Well, the first question is, which is the real importance of the quality control in fiber-reinforced concrete? First is the quality assurance of the material and protection against the third parties in case of any problem. The question is, the current control we are carrying out in work jobs with fiber-reinforced concrete is correct or not, or this control can be optimized? This is the question. See, the first question is how we calculate with fiber-reinforced concrete, which are the main parameters we use for the design. Normally, what we use for design is the characteristic values of the material, of the resistance strength, which is the average value, less coefficient, 1.64, and the deviation of the material. This works for compression, also works for tension, in this case for post-cracking, the tensile strength of the material. See that how affects the number of specimens we test in a batch to this number, to the K coefficient. See that if we increment or if we increase the number of the test, this number is being reduced, which means that the characteristic value tends to be the average value. So, in terms of post-cracking strength, which are the tests that we are using currently in our standards? Normally, we use the beam test. They can be 4-point bending test or 3-point bending test. In some cases, we use the 3-point bending test with a notch. This is the most used test for characterizing the post-cracking strength of the concrete. There are other tests, like the panel, and this is a test which is called the double punch test or the Barcelona test, because we are in our university have made some developments for increase the accuracy of the test. What is important of this table is this, is the coefficient of variation that every test leads in the results. See that normally the beam test provides variation coefficients between 12-15% up to 25%. While the other tests, the variation coefficients are below 13. And this affects a lot when we want to calculate the characteristic value, because if we have a bit dispersion on the test, it means that we will have a lower characteristic values when we design. And this is only depending on the test, not depends on the variation of the material. So let's put an example to see which is the real importance of using tests that minimize the variation coefficient. This is a real example in a precast tunnel in the north of Europe I'm working on. It's a tunnel in which 500,000 cubic meters of concrete is being produced. It's a massive concrete production. So minimize the variation coefficient of the fiber-reinforced concrete is of paramount importance. In this tunnel, we fixed a value of 2.1 megapascals for the characteristic value of the post-cracking strength. And we were asked to answer the question, which would be the test that minimized the variation coefficient. So, we considered the bending test, traditional bending test, considering a variation of 20%, and the double bar test, punching test, or the Barcelona test, which leads to 13% of variational coefficient. And see, these are statistical results, and see that that for this value of 2.1 millimeters, considering the Barcelona test, the beam test, see that the 6%, every 6% of the batches could be uncomplaining. I mean, should be rejected because we don't achieve the minimum characteristic value of the strength. Instead, if we use the Barcelona test, this number produces below 5%. And now imagine that instead of testing with the Barcelona or with the beam test, we test the full scale segment because it was for a precast segment tunnel. See that the uncomplaining patches are very low. What does it mean? It means that the escape term of the results is depending very much on the length of the element and on the testing we are considering. If we translate this in fiber consumption, these are the results. For 2.1 megapascals of characteristic strength, if we want to make the quality control with the beam test, the amount of fibers is around 24. If we use the Barcelona test, it's around 22. And if we test real scale elements, the amount of fibers is 20 kilos per cubic meter. So, just modifying the test, in this case we have 2 kilos per cubic meter of concrete, of fiber. Sorry. Imagine that if we translate it into the massive construction of concrete, which was 500,000 cubic meters, it means that more than 2,000 tons of fibers of difference for the construction. And if we translate it in cost and money, it's a lot of money just using different tests. So see which is important of choosing the best testing for the quality control, especially for the quality control. See, another thing that we noticed when we test fiber force concrete is that these are different flexural residual values for the concrete, fiber force concrete. Normally the FR1 is the one we use for surface limited state design, and FR3 or FR4 is the one we use for ultimate limited state. See that if we increase the fiber amount, the variation coefficient reduces drastically. Yeah? This is because the fiber amount and the probability of having fibers in the crack equation. Yeah? So the higher is the amount we work, the lesser will be the variation coefficient. This is very important because when we work in real scale elements, for instance, slabs, this is a real flat slab for a building, the variation coefficient that we obtain in the test is less than 5%. Why it is? This is because the cracks that we obtain in ultimate limited state or semi-limited state have a length of more than 4 or 5 meters. If we go to pipes here, that what we were talking yesterday, here the length of the pipe is 2 meters. It leads to a variation coefficient of 9%. And lastly, if we go to the precast segments, in this case, this has a length of 1.5 meters, the coefficient of variation is 10%. So what is important, what I want to notice here is that we are testing or characterizing the concrete with very small elements. Because the elements are very small, the variation coefficient is high. But in reality, when we test the real scale elements, this variation coefficient is lower. Now, This affects a lot in terms of design. So the question is here, which are the types of a skater and which are the sources of a skater? We have first the skater because the testing procedure, yeah, depending on the test we choose, the revision coefficient will be different. The production of the concrete affects on the variation coefficient, and the intrinsic skater, which depends on the statistically of the fire force concrete, orientation, position of the fibers, dosage, and all these things. So, what we wanted to make here is to simulate how the fiber distribution and the fiber type affects on the variation coefficient. So, we prepared a numerical model, very complex, and we made 35,000 attempts or simulation with this model. I don't want to go further in the model, but what we make here is a model that is capable to distribute fibers in an element, in randomly position, with randomly distribution, and the idea is to modify the length of the element and see numerically how this affects to the variation coefficient. So what we did here is to study different heights of the element between 125 and 300 millimeters, width of the element between 150 and 2000 millimeters, different types of concrete, normal concrete and self-compacting concrete. Self-compacting concrete tends to align the fibers, to distribute better the fibers. And so, see the results. Here, what I want to show you, if I can Russian, here is the width of the element. And here is the variation coefficient of FR1, the value we use for surface solid state. Consider, for instance, the amount of 30 kilos of per cubic meter of fibers. And let's consider different heights. See that, for instance, for a width of 500 millimeters, if we compare the blue line with the orange line, we see that with the lower height, we have higher skater of the results. And if we go to the one with the 300 millimeters of height, the skater is drastically reduced. But now, independently of the amount of fibers and the height of the element, see that the greater is the width of the element, it leads to convergence of around 3% of variational coefficient independently of the other variables. This is important because it is saying that when we work with pavements, slabs, elements, surface elements, the variational coefficient of the real structure reduces a lot. This is very important in terms of analysis. We can see here the same. For a short element or a crack or element with a width of 550 millimeters, which is the beam test we use for crack testing the concrete, the variation coefficient is between 8% and 12%. But if we go to real scale elements, see that the intrinsic coefficient of variation reduces drastically. This is again very important. So with this model, at the end, what we notice is that we can correlate the variation coefficient with the height of the element and the width of the element. And using other equations, we can obtain this variation coefficient. But normally, how we work? Normally, we consider, when we want to assess the characteristic value, normally in compression, flexural, or other variables, we correlate the average value with the characteristic multiplied by 0.7. Here, we are making an assumption that the distribution of the results is of normal or Gaussian, with a variation coefficient around 12%. But this sometimes is not correct. So, what we proposed with these simulations is to correlate the average value of residual strength and the characteristic value using the height and the length of the element, which is more precise, because at the end we are designing the element considering the actual or the real dimensions of the element, not the results of the beam test. We put the value of the big test here, but we multiply with this correction factor. So we are able to consider the real variability of the market. So another thing I want to talk about the advances of Firefox Concrete is that the Barcelona test we normally use for correct transition, the BIM test. The BIM test consists of BIM with 600 millimeters of length and square cross section of 150 millimeters by 150 millimeters. The thing is, these specimens weigh around 30 kilos, and the time that consumes for carrying out the test is around 45 minutes, which is a lot. Yeah, and the type of results you obtain is something like this in terms of force and crack mouth opening displacement. I mean the width of the crack here. The thing is, normally the traditional control labs they are not able to carry out this test. It's very technological, this test. So what we propose is to use the double punch test, which is a very very easy test. Consists of a cylindrical or a cubic specimen. We put two steel punches in the strings. We use the same testing machine that we use for compression, and see, at the end what we obtain is something like this, the cracking pattern. So if there are cracks, it means that we are testing the fibers. So this is the idea behind, it's like a direct testing. We can do like this with a circumferential chain, which is measuring the opening displacement of the cracks, or with the new advances, we are able to do the Barcelona test only with the control of the vertical displacement without any circumferential change. The behavior is something like this. Let me show you in this final picture. We have first a linear stage, then a cone is formed just below the steel punches, the cone. This is not an element that we put. This is formed because there is a triaxial compression stress right below of the steel punch. And see, the punch is penetrating, and while it's penetrating, the crack is being opened. So we are able to test the fibers in this concrete. So these are the type of results we measure. We can correlate the vertical displacement with the crack mouth opening using constitutive equations and things like this, but I think I need more vodka to talk about this here today, so I'm going to get rid of this. And see, what is important is that we are, we are able to consider, to correlate the vertical displacement, with the deformation. So we are able not to use the chain, which is much more easy to carry out the test. So another question is, if normally in the design of elements we use the BIM test, this is the most extended test for designing, to obtain the constitutive equations and to design elements, any kind of Firefox concrete elements, how can we introduce the Barcelona test in the design? So what we do is correlations. Correlate this with this in the pre-design situation. Is it possible? Yes, we do it normally. We correlate the compressive strength with the modulus. We correlate the compressive strength with the tensile strength. So this is normal. And at the same time, the standards allow to do this, as they permit to correlate the BIM test with Barcelona test, provided that the correlation we are doing is safe. So we are doing this in several tunnels, but what we do, or certainly it could be in tunnels, in pavements, in any structural element. Initially what we do is some BIM test, we do with the same concrete and the same batches, Barcelona test, we obtain the results. These are the cracking resistance in the BIM test, this is the cracking resistance in the Barcelona test, and we correlate, we obtain the ratio between this. And we obtain the FM3 values for ultimately the state. We do the same for the Barcelona test, and we correlate. And these are the values. So, which is the idea behind this? The idea is to provide these correlations and during the quality control, not using the BIM test, but using the Barcelona test, which is much more easy. For instance, the cost of the double blind test, or the Barcelona test, is 3 or 4 times lower than the BIM test. And the time that the Barcelona test consumes for just one testing is less than 5 minutes. While, as I was saying, for the BIM test, it's 45 minutes. Yeah? So, what we propose, and what we do in massive construction, is to provide this correlation between the Barcelona and the BIM test using these coefficients. Of course, if we change the concrete, or we change the fibers or the amount, we have to make the same correlation, but it's very easy. Another thing which is important that we are considering is how to measure the orientation and the amount of fibers in concrete. This is another question. What we do normally is crushing the concrete, count the fibers, yeah, and then weight and verify if the amount of fibers in the concrete coincides with the amount of fibers that we have to put in the concrete. This is a very long test, difficult, and we have a schedule. What we have developed is magnetic test, which is very easy to carry out. This is a copper ball in a cylindrical plastic element. We induce current, and what we obtain is a magnetic field. Magnetic field is produced a vibration inside the concrete because of the inductance, and what we obtain is the amount of fibers, but without any destruction of the element. So it's a non-destructive test, and the time consuming here is less than 5 seconds. Yeah. And the question is this method reliable? Yes, it is. These are the values for a specific concrete. The estimation of the amount of fibers with the magnetic test, and this is the real values crushed of the amount of fibers crushing the specimen. You see that all are aligned. In this case, we justified, or we saw that the trueness of the test is lower than 0.35 kilos. I mean, it's a very, very precise test. And what we are doing nowadays is do the magnetic test to obtain the amount of fibers and then testing in the Barcelona procedure. So it's a very optimized test because we are able to know which is the amount of fibers and we are able to know which is the post-cracking residual values of this. So we did it not only with cylindrical elements, but as well with prismatic elements. We structured cores from segments to see which is the distribution of the fibers depending on the position. We do the same in slabs. So it's a test that has been proved and has been calibrated a lot. So nowadays, this methodology, Barcelona test or double punch test and the magnetic test is we are implementing and we are using this test in different towns around the world. Ottawa in Canada, in Peru, in the north of Europe, in Norway, in UK, in Spain. So it's a combination of testing that for massive concrete production it's very interesting and has a very good outcomes in terms of technical and economical things. Well, this is all I wanted to say. Thank you for your attention.
Mr. Albert, I would like to ask you, you use metallic fibers, steel fibers in your tests? The fibers and the steel fibers provided better result. Plastic fibers have other orientations and other results for frost resistance. So we tested them for and plastic fibers in terms of frost resistance and water tightness. The results for plastic fibers were like 20% better, and we measured the volume, 600 grams of steel of fibers, and the difference in the volume of fibers was great, and the distribution of fibers of plastic fibers are better to be distributed in concrete than steel fibers. And you spoke about the width. You have 3D, 4D, 5D, and I would like to know if you tested the fibers only with one width, and if you tested plastic fibers, could you say tell the proportion? So there are different shapes of fibers that work for cracking, crack resistance. And what would be the proportion that you could use plastic fibers in combination in this tunnel segments? So you could probably consider the use of plastic fibers and maybe plastic fibers in combination with steel fibers, using, for example, carbon coating, could help you reduce the thickness of precast elements. It could help you save concrete and provide water insulation.
Fibers are more meant or more thought to control the crack width, for lower crack width. But if you want to have good resistance in ultimately the same.
I suppose the complexness was the game. Как мелко, если комплексный, если при комплексном использовании, то есть мелкие в виде гусиных фибры и вот эти длинные в виде пластика, вот тогда вот эта пропорция, они же более приемлемы по сравнению с металлическими.
It's better than steel fibers. Steel fibers, you don't have a short, very short fibers. Steel fibers are quite long. You don't have, you cannot have the same size, the same small size of steel fibers like plastic ones.
Okay. Yeah, this is true. When you want to control the crack width, better to use short fibers. And when you want to increase the capacity in the ultimate state, better to increase the length of the fibers. Sorry. If you want to control the crack width, better to use short fibers. And if you want to control or increase the capacity and ultimate state, better to increase the length, but you can use both at the same time. You can use short fibers and long fibers in the same concrete mix. It happens a lot. There is a lot of solution to this.
I see. But I want now how proportion small fibre and more long. How proportion?
It will depend on the element and the type of fibers. But normally. The proportion is
3-1.
Sir, if we take
6 kilograms for one cube concrete, okay? And how I take a small fibre from plastic and more long? How is this proportion?
For
6 kilograms.
Yeah, for instance, you can use for 4 kilos of plastic fibers and 30 or 40 kilos of metallic fibers, long fibers, yes. Short, 4 kilos, long, 30 or 40.
No, if we take only plastic fiber.
Okay.
How this is proportional?
Yeah, 3 kilos of short fibers, 4 or 5 kilos of long fibers, consuming plastic fibers only.
Спасибо большое. Давайте поблагодарим еще раз
нашего докладчика. Thank you very much.